we're going to talk about this morning is what I have slightly tongue-in-cheek labelled chaotic astrology. But I think you'll find as we move through this that what we actually do is chaotic astrology. I'm just actually underlining it and showing a different view of things. One of the things that's a big issue, at least in the UK, I don't know if it's a big issue here, but it's an important question that's actually, I think, raising to the surface in astrology is, what is astrology? What is the definition of astrology? What are we actually doing? And before we can sort of answer what we're doing, we actually have to try and get some form of definition, which is extremely tricky because what's being revealed is that there is no one single definition. There's something else going on. And so it's from that thinking that, and I was always drawn into chaos theory, complexity, etc., that I was focusing very strongly on it for my master's dissertation. I did a master's degree in the UK. And in a sense, what we're talking about this morning comes out of that work. Now, this book is in the bookshop. I'm not running an ad, but if you like what I'm going to be talking about this morning, then you can actually get this in here. Also, I do not want to actually just give you a paraphrasing of the book in this lecture. I'm going to go beyond it, talk about it differently, etc. So this is supplementary material. Okay, to begin this journey into exploring astrology as a form of chaos or complexity, we actually have to just step back a little bit and we actually have to unpack the idea of the difference between something which is complicated versus something which is complex. And quite often people mix those words together, but there is actually a great deal of difference between the two, and that's what's been emerging since the 1970s. This is a statement made, quoted by someone else, but quoted in the book by Paul Silius. He's a process philosopher out of Cape Town, and he's one of the leading thinkers in the philosophy of this other way of thinking. And he said, re-quoting what someone said to him, a jumbo jet is complicated and mayonnaise is complex. And I quite like this. Now, I have no idea of the finite workings of a jumbo jet. I can understand the principles of flight, and I'm sure a lot of people can, but I don't think there'd be very many of us here, unless you're actually an aerodynamics engineer, who would actually understand a jumbo jet. However, we do not do mystery rituals around jumbo jets. Well, we might. In terms of they are complicated, but ultimately, you can keep unpacking them until you can understand every component of the jumbo jet. There is no dark, deep mystery in a jumbo jet when you actually start pulling it apart. However, a mayonnaise, on the other hand, is something totally different. A mayonnaise, as an example of a rather interesting gourmet food, if it's done properly, is made out of components, as we're aware, but I could make a mayonnaise of those components, and a French chef could make a mayonnaise of the same components, and his or hers would be considerably better. A mayonnaise, as with food, is that it has components, but it is about how those components are melded together, and it's about the relationship formed between those components and how that relationship alters and changes within the individual mayonnaise. So, hence, we get this rather lovely statement, which I really like. A jumbo jet is complicated, a mayonnaise is complex. Complicated. Let's actually look at complicated. Complicated is, this is a bit more, we can embrace this in terms of most of us can understand what's going on in this imagery, how it's working. Complicated is causal and linear. Now, what I mean by that is that in this very simplistic diagram, which is like clockwork, we know without really thinking about it that it's these three little characters here are applying the force to turning the wheels, which are turning the gears, which are turning the hands of the clock, etc. So this is complicated. It's fairly simple complicated, but it's complicated. So this is force here. So this is causal. These are the causes of how this order is being formed. And it's linear. He or she turns this, which turns that, which turns this, which turns that, and so on. It's one cause then leads to another cause, which leads to another cause, which leads to another cause. Linear. And it is causal, meaning we can track the causes back. A jumbo jet is the same as this. Except I'd rather fly in the jumbo jet than that, right? But it's the same concept. All action is the result of previous measurable events. So, you know, if we wanted to, we could unpack this and we could look at the amount of ergs, the force being applied to those wheels by those little characters, and we could measure absolutely everything about it. And therefore that is highly predictable because we understand everything about it and we can measure all the causes. This is good. Seeing the world as complicated has given us a lot of benefits. It's allowed us to see the whole world as made up of separate units. Indeed, to work in a complicated world, you must see the whole world as separate units. This bottle of water is totally independent of this lady's cup of coffee. However, it's this lady's relationship to the bottle of water and cup of coffee, which is actually the more interesting thing. But we can see them as totally separate. And we can measure the volume of the water and the volume of the coffee and the water and the temperature of the coffee, and we could then hypothesise maybe the order she's going to drink them in, whatever. Seeing the world as separate things. So in this way, we can study the world piece by piece. And indeed, this is the fundamental philosophy behind science's seeking of the ultimate smallest unit. If you're studying something piece by piece, then it's really advantageous to find the absolute smallest possible unit, which I've forgotten what it is now. But in this quest, you know, went to the atom, then down into the electrons, and then now into quasi-particles, and I've forgotten the name of them. This approach to problem-solving and handling the world is actually called reductionism. And it leads to mechanical technology and scientific success, and we all benefit from it. Within this complicated worldview, there always has to be a prime cause. There always has to be a beginning cause. So if we're looking at this bottle of water, and there's a certain amount of force or energy here holding this water in this column, the water at the top of this bottle actually has potential energy. It will fall out. That could be used to push something. Something to put that potential energy in there is called some machine or whatever, pouring the water into it. We can keep tracking that back, finding the cause of the energy source in that bottle of water. That's a simplest example. And eventually, as you do this, there must ultimately be, if you keep doing it for everything in the world, you have to come back to one primary cause. You can't escape that. It's inescapable. You just keep going back and going back to find the cause before that, the cause before that, what caused that, what caused that. Keep going back, and eventually you get back to a prime cause. Now, in our modern worldview of how order is created, which is almost a modern genesis, this is our prime cause. Our prime cause is the Big Bang. And the Big Bang is this awesome potential just before the moment it does something, and it does something, explodes, which actually the force of that explosion then applies the energy that everything else then moves out from that point. So we actually get the different levels of evolution happening. It's simpler, simpler, then it's getting, as we go through time, it's getting more complex, complex, etc. And then here we have the audacity to have us as the final result. This is not my diagram, by the way. Innocent. This is the causal creation of order. I could segue at this point and talk a lot about creation mythology. Creation mythology is incredibly interesting because all of you have a creation myth deeply embedded in your mind, whether you're aware of it or not. And that tells you how your world works. Now, you all, I think I can safely say this absolute statement, you have all been born into a causal creation myth. If you are of a scientific bent, it is the Big Bang myth. If you are of a more spiritual bent, it's this one. But it is the same story. And here we have cosmos, which, by the way, is the Greek word for order coming out of order, an ordered universe that has been made by something external, cosmos. It's a word I don't like, personally, for astrology. I prefer the word coined by William James, the philosopher, of chaosmos. So I just share that with you. But you have to be brave to use it, because you have to live it then, all right? So cosmos, this is the version before the Big Bang. It's built by an artisan god, who's the prime source, or the Big Bang, but definitely a piece of order, an intellect, a piece of order, that is totally outside of the system, doesn't belong to the system, totally and utterly outside of the system. And then says, bang, Big Bang, make the world, or says, I'll make the world. And this is, of course, a very famous woodcut, but it is a nice example of outside of the eight spheres, we have this mechanical type of imagery. And this was the thinking that God set everything in motion, the prime cause, and then everything would then follow through from them. And we have, of course, with Genesis as a biblical creation myth of order, which is, of course, you know, God decides he is a linear creation myth. He first separates light from dark, and then he separates land from water, and so on the first day he does this, on the second day he does that, on the third day he does this. Are you noticing the causal linearity of the creation myth? On the fourth day he does X, on the sixth day he creates humankind, gives us mastery over everything because we're superior, and then on the seventh day he rests, and then it finishes. That's really important. There is no eighth day in this creation myth. It is not cyclic. It is linear. There's no eighth day. Now, there's many other creation myths that are not linear that actually then go back to the beginning again and keep revisiting this. But I want you just to appreciate that both this myth or this one, there is no, and back again to the Big Bang. There is no. This actually, the ultimate seventh day of this creation myth is entropy and stillness and everything wound down. That's God resting. The eighth day or the seventh day in this one is God having a day off. So this is cosmos, and this is beliefs in how order is created if we believe a linear causal model, and most of us are deeply embedded in that model. That's the thing I just want to highlight for you. You're born into it. What does this mean for you and I who have strayed from this? Because we have. If you're in this room, something's gone wrong. There's a problem, Houston. Some of the natives have escaped. Whoops, going back. Okay, let's just follow this a little bit longer. In this causal or cosmic creation myth, or cosmos creating order, automatically we get the concept of evolution. Because, you know, the Big Bang, we have the levels going through, etc. And so we actually get evolution, which is linear development. And this is a Darwinistic image, which this sort of image you're very familiar with. But what's implied by this image, what's implied is the darkness is here and the light is here. So this is Genesis again. And what's implied is that these creatures here, these life forms, are incredibly inferior to this one. And that this is the superior one stepping into the light, and that these are inferior. And it's implied that these are earlier, primitive, and that this is current and superior. So that's evolution. Evolution is absolutely lives in causality, causal world, and it's pure science and it's cosmos. And it's a word that I would strongly recommend you really think about. If you tend to use it in your life, I'd really sit back and have a look at what it actually means. Because it implies this type of situation, but it also implies that there is superiority. One state is more evolved and therefore better than an earlier state. So that the Homo sapien is more superior than the chimp. Well, I'm sorry, I've met some really interesting chimps. Which I think and they prefer the company of the time. Okay, superiority. This is better than that. So, of course, that's a form of hierarchy. And when we actually, the next point we take when we have this is better than that, that we support that thinking by using reductionism, by seeing all of this as separate. And it leads to the concept of right and wrong and the idea of the truth. I am right, you are wrong. It leads to a sense of my knowledge can be justified, I can show its causal framework, and I can prove it, and therefore this is right. There is no doubt. Descartes defined what knowledge was, and basically he said there must be no doubt. If there's any doubt whatsoever, then it is not knowledge. It is not truth. Just wiped out whole bodies of thought, but we won't worry about that. And of course, from this evolutionary thinking, from this causality, we do get all the benefits of science and technology. And it might sound like I'm slightly sticking or poking a stick at science. I'm actually not. I benefit from it like you benefit from it. I want my world with science and technology. Thank you. Yes, I like that. I'm not good camping. I can do it, but you know. But the difficulty has been is that we have been told since Descartes that this is all there is. And then we have astrology. And therefore, since there's only one way that order is created, which is causal linear, there's only one game in town, then it has to fit into certain requirements. There are some basic requirements of membership and acceptance in the causal linear view of order. There must be a clear causal agent. There must be. Now, even if it's not known at the time, they have to be able to measure and be aware and go hunting for it. There must be a clear, measurable causal agent. It must be subject to reductionism. We must be able to break it down into small units to actually understand it better. And it must be, and this is the real bummer, it must be 100% predictable and repeatable. Because once you understand the causal agent, once we actually let the water fall out of this bottle and turn something, we must be able to put water to that height every time and get exactly the same thing happening every time we release it. We must have 100% repeatability and predictability. And indeed, if astrology, or indeed any subject, so this applies not just to astrology, any subject at all, if it cannot fulfil all three, not just one, all three requirements, then it's deemed to be superstitious or religious belief, and is thus judged as false or not belonging to the truth, which is the truth of science. Therefore, it does not belong to the causal linear world. Therefore, it has no place. It cannot form any order whatsoever. Therefore, it's an illusion. It's fantasy. It's false. It's etc. So, if it cannot fulfil all three of these things, then it is judged to be in this other place. So, clearly, I think after 80-odd years of scientific researching into astrology by astrologers, I think we are generally getting to the point, thank heavens, that we're accepting that astrology is not too good at fulfilling these three requirements. Now, there are still some, and I respect their determination. I don't actually agree with them, but at least I respect their determination, is that if they want astrology to be a science, then the only position left to that group of people, if they want astrology to belong to the causal linear world, is they have to accept the title of pseudoscience. And pseudoscience, which is wagged around, is actually a science in the waiting room. It's waiting for a causal agent. It's a science that's still looking for its causal agent. And so you actually get those groups of astrologers and they tell you they just need to get the big enough database. If they can just get a big enough database or a good enough database, they will show these repeatable results. If they're not too good on talking about the causal agent, right? But It's definitely about get the right technique, fine-tune it, keep tweaking it, get down to the 42nd harmonic of the something rather primary by the oblique ascension or whatever, and you know, like, there it is, go. Oh, it's gone. Damn. Okay. So, for everybody else, there's only other one game in town. If you don't subscribe to the causal linear model and the scientific model for astrology, then since it exists in this universe, and this universe is only defined by causal linearity, get the word out, then there's only other one position, and that is it has to be spiritual in some way, another form, which it may be, but that's the only, there's no other option. That's it. This has incredible variation within astrology, from esoteric astrology and all those variations, right through to the Jungian models, because that's a form of divinity, the divinity of psychological astrology, the divinity of populated by archetypes in your relationship to those archetypes. It's a form of personal divinity. Last night was absolutely wonderful. I really loved it. But it had a very strong theme of Plotinus mysticism, Christian mysticism, which is fine. I don't have a problem with it. But it was presented as a given that we all were in that, we all accepted that, which is fine, but it's just interesting to realise that astrology, if it's going to try and find a place in the world, it's actually gone to Plotinus mysticism and Platonistic philosophy, and that's what it's leaning on, which is okay, may be quite valid. But I hate being restricted to just two options, personally. And I think, is that all there is? Are there only two positions available? Is the causal linearity view of creational order and how the universe works, is it the only worldview? Is that all we have in this world? Is the causal linearity the only source of order? Because we're taught that it is. Our creation myths are that it is. But we can look at other creation myths, and they're really different. They're not, they don't have any linear causality in them at all. These questions are not just being asked by astrologers, but they're being thought about by other people. This is a quote from Paul Silius. This is the process philosopher from Cape Town, and that's the reference for you. And it's an interesting quote, and he's not the first one to say this. The study of complex dynamic systems, dynamic meaning simply moving through time, has uncovered a fundamental flaw in the analytical method. A complex system is not constituted merely by the sum of its components, but also by the intricate relationships between those components. So he's saying there that a complex system is not complicated, it's something else again. Now, he's the most recent in a long line of voices. He has not created this, he's just commenting on it. He's trying to work on the philosophy of it. This, the largest voice that we have in our, since the Enlightenment, of course, is Newton in this area. This is a nice little animated thing that I found. I didn't create it, I stole it off the web. The web is great like that. The web is complex, by the way. Well, becoming so. It's shifting from complicated to complex, which is extremely interesting. Newton, having worked out gravity and basically showing or uncovering some very fundamental causal agents, so really laying the foundation stone for the whole Enlightenment and science and technology to move forward, so very important person, actually indicated straight away that there was a fundamental weakness in reductionism, in the causal model of order. And he called it the three bodies problem. Only took three bodies, right? Only took three things. And he talked about it with the planets, but it applies to anything, bead balls, these little things knocking around there. If you have two bodies, A hits B, B hits C, we can measure, it's like that water and the coffee, etc. We can measure that, and we can totally predict it. As soon as we add just a third component, even if they're just three bead balls, they don't have to have any form of consciousness or anything at all, just three bodies that are actually interacting with each other and giving feedback. So A hits B,
B hits C, C hits A back, B then ricochets off and does something here. And indeed, this is what we're looking at here.
The whole of reductionism, the whole of technology cannot handle that. It breaks down at that stage. Just with three things interacting.
Newton posed this problem, and it is the fundamental weakness of the reductionism. I'm not going to run you through the whole history of the unpacking of this, but the constant study of this has led to, first of all, chaos theory and then complexity. And they basically realised that there wasn't a solution. Now, that's really scary when you're actually believing that anything that doesn't fit into truth is false. But, hey, that's not false. It's there happening in front of your eyes. So, what was found, Edward Lewin's studying the weather, he was trying to apply reductionism to weather predicting. And the idea was that he thought, as everybody thought, you just had to make your computer model more and more complicated, jumbo jet, to fine-tune it, and you will eventually be able to predict the weather. Because if you can eventually predict the weather by breaking down to units, then you can control the weather, of course. That's the whole thinking behind that. And a few things went wrong. Of course, they went wrong late at night when he hadn't had enough coffee and he was half asleep, and that's when other things, interesting things happen in these experiments, and suddenly he discovered something else. And he coined the term the butterfly wings on the west coast of something or other, causing a tornado somewhere else. The tiny, tiny little aberrations have huge implications and totally unpredictable results. It was another scientist who coined it chaos, and he used the word in the original use of the word, the way the Greeks used it, which was chaos, meaning totally unpredictable and totally to be terrified of, which has actually placed the word chaos into our popular language as a negative state. But indeed what started to unfold is that chaos is the creative state. Moving rapidly through a little bit of scientific history, what was found coming out of chaos was that there was a zone before everything really just broke down and went into disorder. There was this, if you increased the amount of relationships between things, living or non-living, and really made it very dense, these relationships, then it could just break into total disorder. But before it did, it actually would start to produce patterns. And the study of that patterns is called complexity science. And this lovely forest scene that I've put up for you is a result or an expression of the huge saturated relationship between different things that will spontaneously create order. And the order in this scene is this. We classify this as order. Now, there's something here for you to grasp which may be difficult to grab hold of. Not difficult in terms of mathematics or anything, but just difficulty because it sits outside all of your worldview, is that this order is created without an artisan. It is inherent within the relationships. It comes from within. There is nothing outside. It cannot be transcended. There is no architect outside that's created that in this model. I could show you many other images, fractals and so on, where patterns, which is a form of order, patterns spontaneously emerge simply by pushing the relationships together. If those doors got jammed and we were all locked in here for 2 days, the water bottle gets really interesting then, doesn't it? What would actually happen, and you know, you're aware what would actually start to happen, is that other dynamics would start to happen. Leaders would emerge, people under stress would emerge, there'd be patterns forming, there'd be subgroups forming, there'd be all sorts of patterns would start actually occurring. Because we are complex, we are relating with each other, and if we sealed it off and just got us, then we know that order, patterns, good or bad, would spontaneously emerge, for better or for worse. But there would be the spontaneous emergence of order. And it would not come from the direction from the Big Brother studio, you will now all move to the left. You know? It wouldn't come like that. There's no outside. It would come from within.
Okay.
So complex systems are, here's a nice image of complex systems, are living systems. And by definition, because they're the relationship, they are non-hierarchical. There is no superior or inferior in these models. They are complex rather than separate. They require their relationships. They cannot be separated out. You can't take something out of its environment and dissect it and still understand or learn about it. They are holistic, with a H rather than a W. They are holistic. They are, of course, all living systems, but they're not exclusive to living systems. They are cyclic rather than evolutional. They will actually keep returning to an early state and repeating themselves. You're cyclic. You're born, you'll die, you'll have other children, maybe, right? Who are born will die. There's a return to the first occasion. You hold your grandchild or your child in your arms and you look for the father's or the mother's face or the Aunt Nellie's face, or you look because you're actually returning to the first occasion when they were little. In the Inuit cultures, they're actually called by those parents' names or grandparents' names who are dead. And they're welcomed as the return of that elder and treated as that elder because they are returned to that person, and so on. It's cyclic. They are involving all networks, good networks about relationships, and they are most importantly self-organising. Just as I said with this room, if we seal it, there will be a form of self-organising. We may not like it, but it will occur, whether we like it or not. We're not going to sit here and stay neutral if we seal this room. There's going to be movement at the station. Okay, so complex or non-linear dynamic systems, which are the complicated ones. Complex systems, just a few examples. The weather is a complex system. So many things affecting something else that it cannot be 100% predictable. Indeed, I actually think astrologers do better weather predicting than the Bureau of Met. I used to have a client who was the director of the Bureau of Meteorology, and I was fascinated, and I said, you know, how do you actually do it? You know, what does it happen? They say, well, they sort of go and they do all of their, you know, looking at all their measurings and pressures and temperatures and satellite images and so on, and then they sit down together over a cup of tea, about five or six of them, and they intuit what the weather will be. You can't take the human out, you know. Okay. Organic, inorganic systems, the biosphere and the weather are complex. They're now accepted to be complex. This is complex. The stock market is actually particularly, you know, one of the major indexes, the Dow, simply a measure of greed and fear in the human collective. That's all it is. It's just a measuring of emotions and it has no meaning than that. And it's created by intense networking and communication between people, and suddenly a pattern will emerge and that will make it go up or make it go down, but that's all it is. It's complex. People or living systems are complex, whether they are herds, flocks, communities, cities, tribes, cultures, families, and so on, function in complex models. And your life is complex. You knew that. You didn't actually need me to tell you that, by the way. But your life is complex. An individual life is subject to feedback. Like, if you're not subject to feedback, you're dead. It's as simple as that. And because that feedback is from more than one source, you're not just an A, B, that's it. You're an A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, blah, 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 right? You go on and on. It's extremely complex. And so your life is complex. We can add time into this difference between complicated and complex. Complicated systems, that's a jumbo jet one, causal linear systems, they move through time by unfolding. 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 If I fold this and then I unfold it, I know exactly what I'm going to get. Unfolding is 100% determinism.
unfolding is totally predictable. Causal systems are moved through time via unfolding. Complex systems, your life, move through time via emergence and self-organisation. Your life doesn't unfold, it emerges. And it's important, I believe, as astrologers, to be very clear in the use of those words and to be clear in how you use them. If you're going to talking to a client about something in the future, if you're talking, you should be using words like emergence, the emerging patterns, the emerging potentials, not the unfolding patterns, because you're implying a level of hard determinism as soon as you use the word unfolding. But what they have found in studying complex systems is they are order spontaneously emerges without an artisan god. The order comes from within the system itself, and as it emerges, it self-organises. The same as if we seal this room, then there would be a form of self-organisation would happen. So causal linear systems, moving through time, unfolding through time, are 100% predictable and with a 100% level of accuracy. And each component of the system is understood and is an extreme form, or is the form of reductionism. Whereas complex systems, and this is where it gets interesting, folks, this is the fun part of the lecture for the astrologers, complex systems emerge and can only be sensed by the observations of patterns. Whoa. We've just actually got the whole of divination embraced in that statement. Looking at clouds, reading tea leaves, looking at the beginning of an emergent pattern in the whole complex system, the looking at patterns. A pattern, of course, is a regular or rhythmic repeating of an image, sound, or event. Music is pattern. So the rhythmic repeating of an image, sound, or event. And such repetition in complexity science is called self-similarity. And the emergence of patterns over time or space is called scale invariance. Let's just look at those two terms, they're quite important. Self-similarity. Waves on a beach. All the same, but each one is different. Waves on a beach. That is self-similarity, repeating. Scale invariance. A river system viewed from 5 miles up looks very similar to lungs. Similar images over different scales. So, a few images here of the way that order is created is self-similarity. Here's a nice example, a very simple example of self-similarity. The spots on this leopard. Each one is totally different, but each one is similar. All of life is filled with self-similarity. This carpet is an example of self-similarity, a bit mechanicalised. You are an example in this room of self-similarity. We are all the same species, but each one of us is different. But from some alien, whatever, we are all the same. Self-similarity, repetition via self-similarity. Scale invariance, this is an anthill. Here we've got some clouds, and of course that's sort of a nebula. The scale invariance is huge. Scale makes no difference. The self-similarity occurs in shape or form over a diverse scale. This is how order is created when the system is complex. So we can ask the question, is astrology complex or is it complicated? Does it belong to this world of networks and relationships of self-emergent order? Or does it belong to the causal linear model, which is science? If we're going to map astrology onto another way of thinking, if we're going to map any subject onto another way of thinking, there has to be an advantage in doing so. There has to be a win in it for the subject. It has to help in the definition of the understanding. It has to apply a sense of understanding the subject or add new methodologies or insights that you didn't have before. Otherwise, it's a waste of time. And that's a very important criteria when you're looking at taking one body of knowledge and putting it with another. Does it help? If it's just actually fancy, sexy language that gets you more lecture slots at a conference, it's of no bloody use. It has to be of real practical use in some way, philosophically or practical. Does it help us? Well, the first thing it does is if we consider that astrology is complex rather than complicated, we get rid of this. We immediately break this and or that's it. We break that polarisation. For 80 odd years, if not longer, the debate in astrology has been, is it a science or is it spiritual? And it's the fight. And you still see it happening. Tension. And we don't even have to engage with it. We say, okay, fine, okay. We'll just go over here. Because it doesn't have to be either or neither. It's not a science, doesn't have to look for a causal agent, doesn't have to be called pseudoscience, doesn't have to go searching for a bigger database, and doesn't have to be subject to the skepticism of, or judgment of truth and untruth, false or not correct, etc., of the model of reductionism. It therefore also doesn't have to have a soul. Sorry, I don't mean to offend. It doesn't have to. It may have. Doesn't have to. Doesn't have to have some form of divinity in it. It may have. Please recognise. I'm just saying it doesn't actually then require it as a default position. And as soon as you can actually handle that one, it really does open up all sorts of interesting thinking in your mind. Doesn't have to be either. What else do we gain? So that's the first thing we gain by saying astrology is possibly complex. And that to me is enough to make it a done deal as far as I'm concerned. But I think there's more. There's state nines as well. It can give, via what complexity gives us is the findings of complexity of self-similarity and scaling variance can really give us an understanding of the role and purpose of the use of astrological cycles in an individual's life and give an insight of repeating astrological themes within a family via the ideas around self-similarity and scaling variance. A family is complex and therefore there will be a self-emergent order over generations. And as astrologers, we understand that. We talk about family patterns. You know, the baby's born, everybody else is looking at, does he have his father's eyes? What are the astrologers doing? What are they doing? Oh, my God, the mother's boom! Right? Oh, it's great. We're looking for the self-similarity in the patterns. Outside of astrology, in psychology, we get the acknowledgement of this. Indeed, complexity science has penetrated very deeply into psychology. Family patterns, patterns in life, self-similarity and scaling variance, the sense of patterns ricocheting through family. This is a really interesting book. I don't know, I just got this off the web, but another book, but the subtitle, which you can't read, is Breaking Free from Family Patterns and Becoming Our True Selves. The true has capital T. There's a fundamental problem in this title. I personally don't want to break free of my patterns because I think that's where my personal divinity is. Right? I live in a pattern. And I think you do as well. But whatever it is, you can do your thing, but I'm not getting out of mine. I may try and alter it and change it, but I'm not going to abandon it because abandoning it is death. So family members, a family pattern, let's look at some. They started to realise every single family has family patterns. So all of that stuff which you've always thought was weird, funny or odd, because that's how science defines it, is actually now considered healthy and normal. So family patterns like members of the family born or dying on the same day happens all the time. Family members entering similar professions as ancestors. Family members marrying at the same age over different generations. Family members having the same number of children or gender of children. I'm sure now you're all thinking of your family patterns. I've got a friend, extensive family, every single member of the family is born on the 11th or the 22nd of some month. They were getting married, two people getting married, one of the son who was born on the 11th was marrying someone who was born on the 22nd, keeping it all nice and neat. They got married on the 11th of the 11th, right? At 11 a.m, he was very aware of this, going to the wedding, he stopped in at a lotto shop, bought a scratchy ticket and won £1,100. Which paid for the honeymoon. We say, wow. Complexity says, no, just a good pattern. Quite acceptable, quite normal. realise this as well.
This is, once again, I'm not supporting any of this. I'm just simply pulling covers off the web. Your acceptance of mythology in your love, if you are Jungian psychological astrologer, your acceptance of the way your life can lead a myth and the impact of that is actually the way that you handle that you are living your life in a repeating story, in a pattern. And what is a piece of mythology? What is a myth? A myth is simply just a well-established pattern that you've subscribed to. That's all that a myth is. It's a collective one. It's one that's generalised. And you run it, but you run it in a self-similar way. That's the running of the myth in your life, but actually slightly different to the main story. But you can see the themes of it. These patterns of repeating themes are now, within complexity thinking, the expected manner in which order emerges in your lives and the history of your family. This is how order is created. Here's a family pattern. You're all familiar with them. This is the Kennedy family. Obviously, the Kennedy family has a pattern of tragic death within its story, its narrative. We could segue now and talk about attractor basins and strange attractors, and that's another whole thing. But the thinking is now that attractors come and live in a family, and you trust us, the whole sense of three generations of these amazing musicians, obviously in that family, came to live with them, was this whole concept, an attractor basin that produced music as the order within the family. So here's an obvious one, the Kennedy family over different generations. You're all familiar with them. Complexity science suggests that we live in a pattern. And if we could, I'm not saying we should, but if we could map it out, if there is a way, and you wouldn't want to because then you've got to apply reductionism to it, but if you could, it may look like this Persian rug. And what complexity science suggests is you're born into a pattern, and this is the really interesting for astrology, your fate, your destiny, is to be loyal to your pattern, your family's or your cultural patterns, to maintain the pattern, to contribute to the tapestry and the emergent order of your family, your group, your tribe of astrologers. You've got many levels to this, but to contribute and to maintain it. So it becomes very interesting for astrology. We start to gain, by putting complexity and chaos into astrology, we start to get a suggestion that we may be able to look at fate. The F word, the four-letter F word in astrology, by the way, we may be able to actually look at it in a little bit, a different way, come at it from a different angle. Just a suggestion. So we actually get the concept within complexity that this could be two different families, this could be two different individuals. This one might be a little bit more absolute. They believe this, they believe that, this, whereas this other one, Florentine thing, right? Could be someone who's extremely Gemini, right? I mean, I'm slightly tongue-in-cheek, but what I'm suggesting is these patterns are varied, but complexity suggests that you live in a pattern, that you're loyal to these patterns. For those of you who are doing the workshop, the post-conference workshop, we're going to look at how you know when you're about to draw something new in your pattern, and we're going to look at ways of playing around with that, but I don't want to segue into that at this point. So the other thing that complexity gives us as a possible mapping for astrology is complex systems cannot be totally predictable. Does that ring nice, comfortable bells for you? Nor are they controlled, but are very, very sensitive and responsible to intention. They've actually now, it's official, they realise that actually, that's a great announcement. The intention actually helps form the patterns. Wow. Right. You intend something. If you hold something in your mind and you intend it, that's what we call it, a meditation. We call it a mantra. A mantra is an intention that you're repeating, 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 repeating to create new order. Does this start to ring a few bells for you? You're actually actively engaging in a complex model, trying to create new order using the
thinking of complexity. Intention can be expressed by creating a small, repeating pattern, a mantra, in the hope of helping that pattern emerge through the complex system. And there's all sorts of ways you can move with that thought. It's very rich in its potentials. And we can think mantras and we can think spiritual activity, but it's more prosaic than that. Why don't you all tomorrow put your watch on your other wrist when you get dressed? I bet half of you, if not 80% of you, can't do it. Because you'd be changing one of your wrist. Oh, no, watch, this is a good solution, right? You'd be changing one of your little personal rituals which make your day. The way you create the order in your day. You want your coffee, it has to be a certain strength, you want the right brand, the right sort of milk, or your cup of tea. If you don't get that, then you complain to your friends that you ran out of coffee and the whole day went to hell in a handcart. Why did your whole day go to hell in a handcart? Because one of your rituals which maintained the order of your day got altered, and therefore there was a different form of order in your day. So it's not just meditations and mantras, which are immensely valuable and are and sit very comfortably in the findings of complexity. But it's more simple than that. It's simply the brand of water you like to drink, or coffee, or the clothes you wear, the way you drive to work or travel to work. If you are stuck with something in your life, change something. Put your left shoe on before your right shoe. Put your left or right arm in your shirt or jacket first. Do the opposite to what you normally do. Change it while thinking about what you're doing, why you're doing it, and you can help the new order emerge in your life. Now, we're talking sort of about co-creating. We're talking about the feng shui of one's life. We're talking, you know, we can put all sorts of labels in there, and they're all really valid. So you can label it however you want to. Okay. This is not a new thought. Kun, one of the oldest creation gods, Egyptian, 5,500 BC, would look. First of all, there was the mixing of the Nile waters, and the silt started to swirl into a pattern, and this character emerged. Note he is polymorphic. Note he is part human, part something else. Always a good indication that complexity or chaos is the creation myth. This is not causal linearity. He emerges. Note the word emerged, that's their word, not mine. And then he looks for other silt as it forms, and he reaches down and shapes it on his potter's wheel. And he creates all humankind. This is the soul and the individual. And periodically, he returns to the first occasion, that's the Egyptian terminology for it, and he goes back into the Nile, and then he re-emerges again, and the whole thing happens again. It's cyclic. So this is not new. And the sense of intention to create the order that's required is also not new. These are the Ishtar gates to Babylon. This is not a lookalike. This is the Ishtar gate to Babylon. I think it's in Berlin. I think.
Yeah, then yes.
Yes, right. Great, thank you. The study of these glazed tiles, these blue glazed tiles, they've done a lot of work in trying to understand how they were made, and they realise it's an immense amount of work. Also, very high death rate amongst the glazers because of the heavy metals they were working with. And huge investment of life and time and effort and money into creating this. Why? Well, they sort of wanted water there. So they created it so it would come there. This is complexity thinking. The intent, the ritual, creating it, bring it there. Make it come. Make it live there. Want to be there. A mundane example, it's an everyday life. I mean, one time I had a client that wanted to see if they were ever going to have money. So I talked to them about money and I said, well, you know, do you balance your bank statements? Do you keep a checkbook? You know, oh no, I'm unused to that. Don't really, you know, can't do that, whatever. Had no idea of budgeting, how to work out bank accounts, how to just sort out things like that. And I said, you want money to live with you, but you're not creating a place for it. If you want money, which is energy, in your life, then do
the simple things that makes money feel more comfortable so it comes into your life. It's really simple, right?
So this is the same thing. This is the same as these Ishtar gates. Intention in a ritual that creates the emergent order that you're after in the complex pattern of your life. Okay. Also, complexity brings in the concept of tipping points, a term coined by Malcolm Gladwell for when something gets intense but no change happens, but it's just building up the relationships, and then suddenly, woof,
the whole new order emerges. So the point of where the new order emerges is actually called a tipping point.
And complexity science is amazed and in awe and in wonder at this concept. We've known about tipping points forever. We call them a transit. when is my life going to change? Well, the Pluto transit should do it.
Here is a tipping point.
And what's really interesting with a tipping point is that complexity, I go to complexity conferences, and they all are about how on earth can we, A, find out when these tipping points are going to occur, and how can we steer them into the order that we want. And then I go to astrology conferences, and they talk about Pluto transits and how can we understand them to get so the client can get what they want out of it. That sounds a bit fatalistic, but do you know that sense of getting the new emergent order coming through? We know as astrologers, we actually are empowered, and I think we are empowered personally, with understanding when the tipping points are going to occur in a person's life. And by sharing those with a client and talking about the emergent new order that they may require and talking to them about how they're going to hold that intent and talking to them about personal rituals, not necessarily religious ones or spiritual ones, but personal repeating patterns, they can be spiritual or otherwise or all, before the tipping point to help create the new emergent order can be a really interesting way the individual can co-create their life. Now, I stress the word co-create because in complexity, you cannot create because there's not a hierarchy and you are not superior. You have no more agency in the system than this bottle of water. I'm really glad you bought this bottle of water. In other words, you can co-create. You are on the same level. There's no hierarchy. It's a flat plane. And you accept that position of your normalness, right? And then you can engage with everything else happening around you and be like Kunin, help pull out of the swirling suit of the Nile the intentions or order that you actually want. So the combination of complexity with astrology provides a person with an understanding and a methodology, or rather provides the astrologer with an understanding and a methodology, a small m on that word, a methodology for helping an individual co-create their future, for having an insight into what is the determinism within astrology, which is clearly my major interest, what is the nature of determinism, helps us or provides us with an out clause to the split between it's science or religion and that's it. We can let them go off and play. We don't have to engage in it. And in a sense, what we're really talking about is that astrology becomes almost like a form of magic, but in a humble sort of way. Not in terms of the magician using their will to impose a new order to emerge spontaneously, which is science engaging with complexity in a metaphysical model, the magician, but rather as a participant, a knowing participant with a real concept, an understanding of intention,
and how to work that with personal repeating patterns and cycles, and looking for those tipping points and talking to your client and talking to yourself about how to co-create the new emergent order that you want, which is maybe, you know, you want to get another job somewhere or whatever the case may be. And when the new emerging order starts to come through, if you start playing with this, you actually need a little bit of courage. Because you have to have the guts to actually reach down and pluck that little bit of soot from the nose. And the way that the new order will start to emerge for you will be not something that's direct, clear and rational. It will be synchronistic. Synchronicity is the mechanism of the beginning of new order emerging. It will be maybe you in a job you really dislike, but you're sort of stuck and you can't seem to change it, and you really wish that you could go and work with something else or do something like that, and you're sort of really annoyed or whatever, and you're walking home and you step on some chewing gum and you get on your shoe and then you stop to get off your shoe, meanwhile you've also picked up a bit of a bus ticket or something, and you pull it off, and on the back of the bus ticket is an ad for some company which happens to be exactly what you're after. You get that, and then you have to make the phone call. You have to be Coonan. You have to then, that's the causal order now. Then, once the new order emerges, then causality comes in, and you make the phone call. Then we have it. So what we actually have with complexity and chaos, and now what's being considered within these models, is that all new order emerges out of complexity. And then causal linearity kicks in. They call it luck, something happens. That's luck. No, you can actually spin it. You can actually help it. You've got to be strong enough to help it. Okay. So, this, for me, sits very comfortably with my astrology. It solves something very deep inside me, a riddle. I feel very comfortable. I can only share with you my personal feelings about it. You've got to make your own decisions. But I feel very comfortable. And then when I unpack it a little bit further, I also realise that astrology emerged from the Mesopotamian culture. And the Mesopotamian culture had chaotic creation myths, not cosmic creation myths, chaotic, cyclic creation myths. And this is the culture that gave us astrology. So straight away we get another big tick as far as I'm concerned, in that who made astrology? A chaotic creation model did, right? Not a causal linear model. And astrology was not invented within the causal linear model. Astrology belongs not in the debate which imprisons it with the causal worldview. Astrology, since Plato, to be honest, I think Plato is the beginning of modernity, personally. Since Plato, astrology has been caught up in this causal worldview, and we have been imprisoned by it. We have been disempowered by it, and we have been disowned by it, because we can't function in it. But we've been told there's no other option. So I don't think we belong in it, personally. And I don't think astrology is a science, nor do I think it's a religion. I think our personal concepts of spirituality can happily fit into complexity. Complexity says the void is not empty. The void is the place where all order emerges. And I find that, I'm a Pisces, 12th house moon, I find that wonderful. To me, the divinity is in the void. And there is no transcendence, there's only immanence. It is everywhere, but there is no outside of it. And I have no difficulty with that. You might have, that's fine. But what I'm saying, it doesn't preclude a spiritual position. Right? It simply removes the artisan god. So I think it's neither a science nor a religion. And I think astrology is complex. And that's why I've written this book. Thank you.